I lost my daughter, Taylor, July 2nd, 2015, to suicide. And then I lost my husband, Eric, November 15th, 2020. We all grieve, and we all grieve from different reasons. It could be a financial hit. It could be a relationship breakup, and definitely from a loss of a loved one. And then we all kind of react differently. So I'm going to start with telling you a little bit about my grief process with Taylor. See, Taylor was the perfect kid. She was beautiful and brilliant, and she was kind, and she was the friend of all friends that everyone came to for support. Taylor was struggling with demons, and she died by suicide by herself in an abandoned house, and my world crashed. Parent grief is like no other grief that can be explained, and the only people who can really understand are the people who are in the parent club. Parent grief is overwhelming. It's suffocating. And I got physically ill, among other things, angry and bitter and just kind of mad at God. We had a whole lot of conversations, me and God did. They were very one-sided. He let me just keep going and keep going and keep going. And he was quiet right then. But it didn't end there. I decided about a year in that I wanted to write a book for parent survivors that didn't involve psychics or feathers or coins. I wanted something to be scripture-based, but I didn't have the skills. So I contacted Pastor Dan Taylor, and we started working and diving through the scriptures. And I didn't really understand at the time that God had led me to Pastor Dan to start helping me unpack some of the emotions that I had. See, the biggest thing I learned about parent loss is that Taylor wasn't mine. She was blessed to me as a gift, as a loan, and that her end date was probably already written when she was born. The book stalled out. But in the meantime, I was asked to speak at a colleague's classroom about suicide intervention. So I did. And 2.5 years later, it's morphed. I now go across the country speaking to high schools and colleges about suicide intervention and how to help your friends that are at risk. Additionally, I volunteer for the Maryland law enforcement programs for suicide intervention. So that grief, I want to tell you, is resolved, but not quite. See, here was the key. I was talking to God, but I wasn't listening. So one of the ways I found to settle my soul was to pray and pray and pray again and then be quiet. And every time I did that, another opportunity was presented to me. And now my girl's name is out there all the time, and I've saved a lot of lives. That helps. Eric and I moved after Taylor died because I couldn't stand being close to where she had passed away. 10 weeks after we moved in 2018, Eric suffered from something called an aortic dissection, which his heart literally blew up while he was teaching spinning class at the gym. He survived a 10-hour surgery, but then fatefully had a massive heart attack a couple hours later. And over the course of several months, he went into complete heart failure. We prayed and we prayed, and some contacts opened up a path to University of Maryland Heart Failure Program. When we got there, Eric was dying, so they inserted something called an LVAD, which is a mechanical heart. So he had a pump attached to his heart, he had a power cord coming out of his stomach, and he literally plugged into the wall at night to stay alive. And he lived that way for 2 years. But let me tell you what happened during that 2 years. He was angry, he was grieving, I was angry, I was grieving. We prayed. And during that 2 years, Eric was able to be involved with our granddaughter, who he never really quite had time for. And he was able to be engaged in the birth of our grandson. And that's what he was living for. So Eric got a call for a heart transplant last October, but he had a stroke on the operating table and then a massive stroke the following day. On my birthday, I gave the consent to withdraw life support, and he died 2 weeks later. My grief for Eric is very different. Parent grief is something, like I said, you can't really explain or resolve right away. With Eric, I think because I had time to grieve and process his illness, and we always knew that it probably, he wouldn't live forever. I was more sad than anything. I was very relieved that Eric was free because he lived like as a warrior. He did everything he could to stay alive. He lived as a warrior and he died as a warrior. And so I celebrate his freedom, but I miss him and I'm sad. So how do we stay connected to God when you're in the midst of so much anger and turmoil? I'll say it again. You have to pray. You have to pray and you have to listen. You have to surround yourself with good core people. My family at Bridgeway kept me going. From the very second that Myra and the frontline team found out Taylor was gone, they surrounded me. They came to my house and surrounded me. Pastor Dan, Pastor Jared, Dr. Anderson, they ministered and helped me get through scriptures and put my name out there as someone who could now help resolve suicide and all of its risk and what we can do. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross wrote a book years ago about grief, and she laid out a linear plan. And while that might work for some people, what I've found is that grief for me is more like waves. It's an ocean. And sometimes you can see the wave coming and you can prepare for it, like on birthdays or anniversaries of deaths. But most of the time, those waves get you when your back's turned. So what I found that when you get into that moment, you have to ride the wave of grief. You have to pray. You have to pray for comfort. You have to pray for resolution. And then you have to listen. And that's how we get through grief.
Atmosphere is changing, nothing stays the same. Heaven is waiting for the mention of the name. The Spirit is moving, burning like the flame, healing the broken by the one we proclaim. Raise it up, fill the sky. Chains will fall, mountains move, we lift him high. Speak the name above all other names. Speak the name, the wind and waves obey. Chains will fall, mountains move, we lift him high.